Hello, friends.
Welcome back.
My name is Ramon.
How are you today?
First and foremost, please excuse me looking the way I do right now, just because this is filmed very, very impromptu. I don't have makeup on. I just got sunscreen. My hair's not done. This is my like lounging outfit. And also, we got a new camera. We're using it for the first time, figuring out all the settings and whatnot. And from the photos we took earlier, you can see all my pores and imperfections. So
take it all in.
But here's the tea. Literally within the last half hour, a post was shared by Inky Decoder spilling the tea that based off a few different in vivo, meaning on real people studies and tests that are done, our good Judy's, the Pareto Centella Green Level Safe Suns, don't in fact have the SPF 50 plus that they advertise, which if you haven't seen my video on the Pareto sunscreens, I talk about how on their website, they had the actual like UV protection test results showcasing that the sunscreens actually provided SPF 84 protection. Basically these tests that Inky Decoder posted showed from different labs entirely, a couple different tests done that's consistently, these did not rank at SPF 84 or SPF 50 or SPF 30 for that matter, but an SPF 19, which that's deceitful, that's a lie. Which in itself might be its own revelation. But I mean, before we get into it, please make sure you hit that subscribe button and notification bell so that you know when I post more skincare, sunscreen, fancy related content on my channel. Give this video a thumbs up and down below, what are your thoughts on this discovery slash based off what I'm gonna talk about in this video? Sound off what your thoughts are down below, just because I don't want you to be discouraged about sunscreens. This video, when I first planned it out, which actually this has been in the works now for a couple weeks, was actually just talking about my own thoughts and perspectives on sunscreen application, sunscreen formulation and whatnot as a cosmetic scientist student, everything I'm learning. I just wanted to share that information. And now that this came up, this is an even better perfect time to do so. This is actually interrupting my holiday gift guide for 2020. Super sorry about that. This had precedence in my mind. I also want to preface this off by saying that I'm coming at this as a cosmetic formulation student. My passion, my hobby, my interests lie in cosmetic formulation, the ingredients that go into your skincare and makeup, why, what they do, what the benefits are. I'm in the middle of my MSc program here in London on formulation. And my end goal at the end of all this is I want to work in skincare, product development, and innovation, but more particularly in sunscreen formulation innovation. This is important to me, and so I wanted to come and talk about it. My boyfriend and I were like, oh, this is major. This is potentially a big deal. So let's turn on the camera. On top of that, as I mentioned, I have a whole other video on Pareto sunscreens, and I'm saying its high praises because I believed, and I'm not having a lot of doubt just yet, but I believed that what they advertised, what they marketed it on the front was true, just because science and testing goes into this. And I was under the impression that the Korean standards of testing were as rigorous, if not more so, than the US standard of testing. So I'm not taking the video down. It's staying up. You can go watch it. But disclaimers, because I have all my notes right here. First and foremost, I don't want this to be a cause for you to distrust sunscreen. Pareto might have potentially done us dirty. I'm still holding on to see what they have to say, what else comes out of this, just because it's not a done deal just quite yet for me. But at the end of the day, sunscreen still does what it's supposed to do and what its intentions are. It provides your skin some level of protection from UVA and UVB exposure and the damage that that causes to our skin. Remember that. And again, it's just really weird that Pareto was so transparent with their results, which is very rare for a sunscreen company to do with sunscreen formulation, more so with Korean sunscreens because they keep those secrets on lock. So seeing this come to light now and seeing the inconsistencies in the in vivo test that Inky Decoder provided versus what Pareto themselves provided, it brings some question of legitimacy to the actual like SPF ratings of sunscreens potentially. And before we get into the actual nitty-gritty of the video, I will also say that in Pareto's defense, what I will praise Pareto for is that they got a lot of people to wear sunscreen. It was a lot of people's first discovery, first foray into wearing sunscreens, and finding a really elegant, high-protection sunscreen that was fun to wear, that didn't feel like a sunscreen, and that they could wear every day, reapply, and not feel heavy. So for that, I will, you know, really hand it to Pareto. They really did that, and in my mind, they actually did a lot to really influence and change a little bit the thought process and people's experiences around sunscreen. And also, at the end of the day, it's still an SPF 19, which is better than SPF 0, and if it got people to wear enough sunscreen and to reapply consistently, I mean, that's something, right? So first and foremost, I really want to talk about how I apply sunscreen, my thought process and my experience with applying sunscreen in real life, actually, compared to what I actually do in the videos. With the videos that I do, I'm really putting these sunscreens to the test based off different metrics, as you've seen with my different chemical as well as my mineral sunscreens, roughly a quarter teaspoon, if not more. That is generally what I do. When I apply the sunscreens, I work them in for a few minutes, but especially with my chemical sunscreens, I'll just like roughly lather them on and really let them set down by themselves without doing a lot of work, I am lazy. And when I do my sunscreen reviews, I'm doing it for the everyday person. I see a lot of people really tell me that, oh, this person and such doctor love these mineral sunscreens and they really work them into their skin for like 10 to 20 minutes. And I'm like, I do not have 10 to 20 minutes in the morning. Ask my boyfriend. You are lucky if I am out of bed at 8:59 for my 9 a.m. lecture online. I don't give myself a lot of time in the morning to do things. I'm not a morning person. So the least amount of work I can do and put into all of this, the better. The tests I do are kind of more a reflection of what the everyday person really has to offer. I don't have 20 minutes to wait before I put my makeup on, before I'm out the door in the morning. I'm lazy. That's how I really apply sunscreens. But on top of that, I also am not the biggest like reapplicator. I'm gonna be real, I don't spend a lot of time outside. If I'm outside and it's like high UV, it's middle summer, UV index is through the roof, I will reapply, and I have various methods to doing so. I have a whole video on that. But real talk, I'm inside right now. It's London, it's gloomy, it's dark, and also I sleep until like 12 or 1 p.m. anyways. By the time I'm like actually up, the sun's gone, so. And that being said, I feel like a lot of people are just like phobic of the sun, and I feel like there's a specific culture of people, and I call it Reddit skincare, that just are very hypercritical and very hyper analytical to an extent that's also extreme of looking at sunscreens and UVA ratings, wanting to protect themselves from the sun, and they don't want to get dark, which in itself is a whole different scope of things. Not dealing with that information, I'm just talking about sunscreens or formulations and my experiences with them for the everyday general public. But also, I just want to reiterate that if you are a person who is hypersensitive to the sun, or you're someone who really puts a lot of work and effort into achieving certain skin goals and you want to maintain them, adequate sunscreen protection, so applying the proper amount, plus continuous reapplication during the day if you're in more high UV exposure, is necessary. So really find a sunscreen that works for you, chemical or mineral, I don't care. But make sure it's a sunscreen that you like to use and you want to use and you will use repeatedly, consistently, period. Because you gotta wear sunscreen every day, all through the year, no matter what the season or weather condition is. UVA does not discriminate. So looking at sunscreen formulation, the nitty gritty that goes behind it, again, I'm still not in the phase where I'm actively formulating sunscreens, but it's something I'm passionate about, have put a lot of research and thought into and have asked questions about, and I'm starting to learn the formulation process of, we're still learning, but there's a lot of things that go into sunscreen formulations. And actually the big reason this video came into play was, on one hand, because people looking at the percentage of UV filters in a sunscreen formulation, which, I mean, Perita was actually one of the big ones in question, and look where they are now, as well as people really getting hypercritical or on the opposite end, not even really understanding or putting a lot of thought into PA rating of sunscreens. And so this next section really talks about what factors into both of those and why those are important and things you have to think about when factoring both of those situations. But talking about what goes into sunscreen formulation specifically, the main hit points for how we get sunscreens ingredient-wise. First and foremost, the actual component of the UV filters, the compounds that make up those filters, whether it's organic, AKA chemical filters, or it's the inorganic mineral filters. Specifically for mineral filters, you're asking how those specific minerals are processed, how are they treated, what the size of those particles are, the integrity of those particles as well. Those all really go into play in terms of like the protection you're getting, the overall elegance of the sunscreen, how it looks on the skin. With the organic or chemical filters, I mean, you have a whole plethora of those available to you, and half the time it's what the FDA approves if you're in the US. But also, again, what percentage of that is in the filter, how those are with both of these homogeneously distributed throughout the vehicle, especially to make sure that you are getting adequate and consistent UV protection throughout the entire usage of the product itself. Secondly, and kind of going off that one point, is the emulsion or the vehicle type of the sunscreen. What are the UV filters suspended in? How are they mixed in? What's the overall situation of the sunscreen? Is it more of a rich emollient texture? Is it oil-based, or is it more lightweight chemical sunscreen that happens to have alcohol to make it a little bit more elegant? A lot of these things go into play with the overall experience of the sunscreen, but also just how the filters are then going to work as a result, and then as a result of that, the overall protection you're getting as well. Because you can have zinc sunscreens that have larger zinc particles, and it has a really high percentage of zinc, and the texture of it is very thick, and it's not the most elegant. You could also have a chemical sunscreen that is primarily, you know, Uvenol, Tinosorb mix, or even a little bit of a mixture of the FDA-approved chemical filters, and it's super lightweight, it's almost liquidy, and disappears into the skin in seconds, leaving you with a matte finish. There's endless possibilities here. Third, and this is to me one of the more important factors beyond just the UV filters, is the film former. And again, sunscreens themselves, how they work is you apply X amount, it's like 2 milligrams per centimeter squared, over the exposed surface area. My quarter to half teaspoon thing covers my face, my ears, my neck, front and back. Don't forget back of your ears too. Applying an even amount of that, letting it set down for at least 5 minutes to be able to adsorb, and form that protective film barrier that it needs to give you that protection, a consistent, unbroken barrier. There are specific film forming ingredients in the formulation that allow that to happen and allow it to happen nicely, elegantly, quickly. And again, that also goes into play into factor how the UV protection works and what the SPF rating is going to be, what protection you're actually receiving. Application comes into play with this specifically just because as the day progresses, your oils break through, you're touching your face, you're doing a lot of stuff with your face, reapplying makeup, I don't know. That film becomes disrupted. And that's why we reapply sunscreen throughout the day, just to make sure you have that consistent film all throughout the day to ensure proper protection. One of the other things I want to touch on that's going to be a big factor in this is secondary ingredients or boosters. They can either fortify, boost up, or just reinforce the protection that the UV filters are providing you. These can be ingredients that in the overall formulation have their own primary benefits, but also pair nicely with the UV filters as well. So like say like antioxidants or maybe like anti-inflammatory ingredients, things that are actually really nice to have in sunscreens. Sometimes they're a little bit extra, but they're also very nice to have in the formulation overall, just because they aid in what maybe that sunscreen formulator is trying to get out of the entire product overall. And then these are also things that tend to stabilize UV filters. Sometimes UV filters, when not combined with the right ingredients, can be very unstable and degrade with UV exposure. But when paired with either other UV filters or with specific UV stabilizing ingredients, they really help to maintain stability of those UV filters to make sure you're getting, again, adequate, more long-term protection as well. It also prevents those ingredients from breaking down and potentially causing more harm to your skin. So now let's start looking and breaking down things like looking at the protection, percentage of the filters, and what else goes into a formulation. And I will be looking at my notes. Sorry, this is very impromptu, so I don't have this all memorized yet. So first and foremost, and this is actually the main reason I want to make this video, is UVA protection. And in my opinion, the limitations of mineral filters, especially zinc, but also especially titanium dioxide. Here's the tea. We know those are both mineral, aka inorganic filters. Zinc oxide and titanium dioxide, they are white pigments. Titanium dioxide more so. It's actually like, remember the Bob Ross painting videos? Titanium white was a color he used, so perspective. Zinc oxide in itself actually does provide a very decent amount of broad spectrum protection. If I can, I'll put a graph here on screen that kind of showcases UV filters and their protection across the spectrum. And for the most part, it covers all UVB, all of UVA 2, and a good amount, if not all of UVA 1. Which are those longer, more deeply penetrating UVA rays. Here's the tea with that is, depending on what particle size is or how the zinc itself is treated or processed or whatnot, and more importantly, the percentage of it in the formulation, that's going to alter the overall effect and the overall strength of the protection you're getting across that spectrum. And that's why sometimes you'll see really high protection zinc-based sunscreens and they just look horrible on the skin because they're just not formulated well. And with titanium dioxide, it's even lower limitations. And with those, you're covering UVB and most of UVA 2, but not a lot of UVA 1. And that's where it falters for me. Some people, they kind of brush off UVA 1, but for me, those penetrate the deepest. Those cause in themselves a little bit more long-term damage. And remember, UVA is aging. That's what breaks down the collagen and elastin in the skin. But more so with people of color, it produces a little bit more of a long-term, longer effect skin pigmentation issues because it's getting really deep down in there and causing a lot more of that issue in the deeper layers of the skin. And that's why a lot of times when you see mineral sunscreen, especially Korean ones, they really only designate a PA 3 plus out of 4 just because the UVA coverage is not the best. It's still broad spectrum, but it's not as high as I like to see. And that's why, in my opinion, my personal humble Puerto Rican opinion, the best combination of sunscreens to get the best UV protection overall, especially up in that UVA range, is going to be a mix of chemical filters. It's going to be primarily even the more innovative filters. I mean, you could throw zinc up in there if you want some zinc and you don't like fully chemical formulations, but the best kind of sun protection you can get, especially that's going to look good on every skin tone, is going to be from organic slash chemical filters. And that's for every skin tone, every skin type, every skin concern. And that's on science. And then with UVA protection, you know, SPF itself essentially just measures the UVB protection you're getting, the amount of time it takes before your skin turns red from UV exposure. Some markets might just designate broad spectrum, and that's going to tell you that you're getting up into the UVA 2, hopefully UVA 1 category, but you don't know what level that is. Other markets might have a PPD rating, or here in the EU specifically, in order to designate that you have a UVA protection value that's at least a third of the SPF rating, they put the UVA in a circle. So for example, if your SPF is a 60, so to make sure that your UVA protection is at least a third of that amount. So if your SPF is 60, your UVA protection is going to be at least a 20. That's when it's in a circle. Here in the UK, I'm under the impression, I've been told, that Boots, which is like, to me, the pharmacist tier, so I don't know, Boots itself is a whole other entity. They have a star rating that also tells you an amount of stars as to the UVA protection as well. So I'm still learning that one. I only really know the Korean PA Plus system. With that one, the more plus is the better. Something I want to say is, going back to skincare Redditors, is they have all these opinions about UVA ratings and what the best is, and I think they are to a certain level kind of extreme about that. But what I will say is that even with SPF, you're not completely blocking out 100% of the UV that's hitting you. As high as you get up, you're minimizing the amount of UV that's being able to cause damage and harm to your skin, but it's not 100%. Unless you're like inside in a dark in a cave, it's not 100%. And that goes with UVA rating as well. With that, you're still getting UVA rays that are hitting you and causing damage to you. And as a result, you're still gonna tan a little bit. I'm someone who I tan really easily with the smallest amount of sun. So in the summer, I have a very wide shade range. Even if I wear sunscreen and I put on antioxidants and I consistently use ingredients that are going to help with like pigmentation and whatnot, I still tan. And that's a reality. You're not 100% protected. So understand that. Now talking about some of the filters, here's something I've been really guilty of. Sorry. I talk a lot about the filters that I use in sunscreens, and I consider myself a filter elitist just because I was from the US and I had a very limited selection, but as soon as I can get out and get other sunscreens, I was buying those up because those sunscreens offer a lot more photo stability, higher protection values, they're a lot more gentle to the skin. My big thing with the American ones was a lot of them were not stable. But here's the tea, and here's something you gotta understand, is most sunscreen formulators are not going to formulate bad sunscreens. They're not gonna formulate sunscreens that immediately degrade and don't offer adequate protection, because if they ever pop and doesn't work, it reflects badly on them. And so a big culprit for this is avobenzone. Avobenzone is the sole organic chemical UV filter we have in the US that protects from UVA rays. And avobenzone's notorious for being photo unstable, but it's oftentimes, if not all the time, formulated with other filters or ingredients in the actual formulation itself to help stabilize and fortify the protection that the avobenzone gives you. And so this is actually my critique for like the Fenty sunscreen, for example, the Hydravisor. I was like, oh, it has only avobenzone and homosalate, and I forget the third one, but I'm like, those are unstable filters. They don't offer great protection. And I mean, I'm still kind of gonna stick to that, but it's not offering no protection to you. It's not offering completely unphotostable protection. And oftentimes you'll find avobenzone formulated with things like octocrylene, or if you're not in the US, tinosorbs or mexorals, which help to stabilize again that protection that you're getting, and therefore it's very stable, very high photoprotective value out of that avobenzone. And again, there are other things put in formulations for sunscreens that aren't sunscreen filters that themselves can help stabilize the overall formulation and make sure that you're getting adequate protection that's more photostable in the sunscreen itself. Continuing on to filters, there's also the question of mineral filters, and actually that's a big reason why my channel has the following it does, is because I do my mineral sunscreen reviews based off the specific white cast, or lack thereof, that mineral sunscreens offer as a result of the filters that they have. And a lot of things go into effect when talking about mineral filters. The size of the filters, again, how they're processed, how fine they are. Annalisa, AKA Skin Perspective on Instagram, actually has a whole post about this that I'll include in the description box just because I think she explains it a lot better. Mineral filters themselves, there's a lot of different variety, a lot of different manufacturers, a lot of ways they can be processed that factor into the overall protection. Not only that, but how they're dispersed throughout the formulation, what they're formulated with, and the overall percentage of them in the formulation as well. So many things can factor in, especially to mineral sunscreens, how they look, how they feel, and how they protect you. And Perita was again a big question, because with their Comfy Water sunscreen, it came to light that that had about 3% of the zinc oxide filter in it. And I'm not here saying that the UV protection on that is accurate either. I'm just using that as an example. With such a low percentage, a big question was made as to how they had an SPF 50 plus for the sunscreen. And again, it comes down to all those things about the filters themselves, but also what else is in the formulation to help boost up the UV protection that you're getting. Things like antioxidants or UV boosting ingredients are things that help to bump up some of the protection values. Vitamin E, for example, is known to help bump up SPF, AKA the UVB protection you're getting out of a sunscreen. So the inclusion of that in your sunscreens helps to change the SPF value you're going to see on the front of the packaging, just because it's not as black and white as you think, I'm going to be honest. And then comparing ingredients from one list to another, they might have the same exact names, but you don't know the quantity of those things in the formulation that affect the overall values of protection or experience or feel that you're getting in the end. And then on top of that, regardless of the size of the filters or the filters you're using altogether, there's a matter of how they're dispersed through the entire formulation. What's nice about chemical or organic sunscreens is that the filters themselves are already evenly distributed throughout the whole thing. That's what's nice about the specific solvents that they use. Alcohol is often demonized for being put in chemical sunscreens, but it helps to dissolve those filters so that they're able to be more evenly mixed in the whole vehicle or the whole product, and that way you're getting the same amount of protection throughout the whole usage of the product. Mineral sunscreens, those are actually a suspension of those filters in the whole vehicle. So essentially when you're formulating those, you wanna make sure that the filters themselves are being able to, again, be evenly distributed through the whole thing. That's why you can't just take zinc oxide powder and mix it in with something and you have sunscreen. A lot of other factors go in, primarily being how the filters are formulated to be sunscreen filters, but also how evenly they're put into the mix. So that way, throughout the whole usage of the product, you're getting a very consistent, very even amount of protection, no matter where you are in using the actual product. That's why it's important to read the directions. Some of the sunscreens that you use, specifically, I remember the First Aid Beauty sunscreen, you had to shake just to make sure that the filters and everything else in the formulation was evenly distributed throughout the whole product. And you wouldn't get an accumulation of filters towards the bottom. And as you use the whole product, you would eventually end up with a much smaller amount and thus less protection. Let's talk about the issue of certain filters getting to the bloodstream. I know for chemical filters, especially the ones that are used in the US, that's a big problem. And my tea with that is there's not enough tea on that. A lot of the tests that are done, a lot of the research that is done, it uses a inhumanely large amount that you wouldn't even use at once, that you wouldn't really be able to achieve over very long-term consistent usage. Those numbers aren't real. It's not realistic. On top of that, the tests are oftentimes done on animals, and I'm not a rabbit. I'm not a rabbit ear. You can't just put a filter on a rabbit ear, see how that acts on a rabbit ear, and think it's gonna work the same on me. I think there's a lot of gray area in terms of the research and studies done on what filters do if they do get to the bloodstream and what that entails. But what I will also say is that there's more research proving the effects of not wearing sunscreen and the damage that that does, in contrast to the few studies that are done showcasing what potential damage that they could do. Same goes for like reef-safe situation. I'm not questioning the necessary legitimacy of that, but what I will say is, again, the results in the studies that showcase reef damage are very unrealistic. They're not practical, and I think it's grossly exaggerated. I think it's distracting from bigger issues that are causing coral degradation and damage, and they're just putting spotlight on this instead of the actual real issues. And also on that fact, there's also a lot of other sunscreen filters, especially the more innovative, more technologically advanced filters they use in Europe and Asia, that are just a lot more safe and have a lot more proof showcasing that those have less of the damaging effects than the FDA-approved older chemical filters. And here's the big thing, going on this whole sunscreen filter thing that really pisses me off and that really irks me a lot, is the whole questioning of what's safe to use for skin of color and why chemical sunscreens are worse and mineral sunscreens are better. Here's the deal, none of them is really better. Just what do you prefer to use, what works best for you. This whole thing of chemical sunscreens, they take UV rays, convert that into heat and give that off, but that heat has the potential to cause inflammation and thus pigmentation in skin of color. Mineral sunscreens work the same exact way. They only reflect a very, very small percentage of the UV rays that hit them. So they still take those UV rays, convert that into heat, reflect that off for the most part. And also the heat that it does reflect off is so insignificant. And that's the other main concern, is that that heat in itself could cause inflammation. It's so negligible, the amount of heat that it actually does convert to, that it doesn't make any sense. And in the same regard of that, you know, people talk about certain sunscreen filters being irritating. I am personally really sensitive to zinc oxide. If I use a lot of zinc over a very consistent period of time, I start to get really irritated, inflamed, dehydrated skin. I don't have those results with chemical sunscreens. Those work great for me. And oftentimes I prefer the way they look, they feel, and they actually help my skin a lot more when my skin's compromised than physical sunscreens. On top of that, I think there's a lot of privilege, and I talk about this all the time, in saying that I only use mineral sunscreens because, again, mineral sunscreens are not accessible. They're not inclusive to a wide range of people. It cuts a lot of people off and it turns a lot of people away from using sunscreens when that's all you recommend. And I think that's actually my big issue with a lot of dermatologists, is that they solely reflect on mineral sunscreens. They really do not recommend adequate chemical sunscreens. And if you have a client that's brown, tan, dark, deep skin, and all you're recommending to them is a sunscreen that won't look good on them, they're not gonna wanna wear that sunscreen. And I think you are being really closed-minded if that's all you're gonna recommend. As much as I don't like mineral sunscreens, I still test them out. I know people want them. I know people want them to work for them, and they wanna know what will work for them. And so I keep an open mind in that regard. As much as I don't like them, I'm still gonna recommend them. I'm still going to be able to try them out for you because that's what you guys want. A big question I get all the time is the issue of blotting and not removing sunscreen protection. What I will say, going back to film formers, is there's things in your sunscreen that is intended to form a film of protection on your face and keep that hopefully very stable, very consistent protection. Once your sunscreen sets down and that film is formed, blotting's only taking off the excess emollients or excess shine that you don't want. And as long as you're blotting gently, you're not rubbing your face, you're not disrupting your sunscreen protection. If anything, I think there's more of a concern of the makeup application going on top, taking off protection, but still, if that film is formed and you're not over agitating your face, you should be fine. And then in terms of sunscreen SPF rating, I actually had written here and now I'm just a little bit like, is that sunscreens go through rigorous testing. They're oftentimes tested in certain conditions and a lot of things are factored into play with them to really get you that SPF rating and the UVA protection you're getting from a sunscreen as well. And I have here specifically that this testing happens in every market, and some other markets are even more rigorous in the US, specifically Korea, which that's a little bit into question now, so. And something else I want to touch on is the inclusion of iron oxides. Iron oxides are really great ingredients to have in sunscreens because they help to prevent blue light damage, which blue light damage is another form essentially of free radical damage that actually has a little bit more of a damaging effect in deeper skin tones. And that's why in a lot of mineral sunscreens, you'll find those iron oxides, because a lot of times they offset white cast and offer a nicer tint that's a little bit more pleasant for more universal skin tones, but they also offer UV light protection. But what I will say, and this goes back to sunscreens being accessible, because oftentimes those tones are horrible. They're so cool tone that even on me, who I'm really mid-tone, and oftentimes those tints are in my skin tone range, they just look gray because it's not my exact skin undertone. So basically, if you want blue light protection, wear foundation, wear a concealer, because those have much higher percentages of iron oxides and they look a lot better on your skin. That's why a lot of times I test my mineral sunscreens with makeup on, because it helps to offset the white cast and helps to then see how makeup wears on top of them so that you can get that blue light protection. And so basically sunscreens, I recommend what I recommend. I review what I review, which is actually a lot of different things that even don't work for my skin tone. But what I will say is that sunscreen success, how they work on specific skin types and tone, is oftentimes individually based. Certain people like certain filters, certain vehicles, certain textures, certain finishes, and that's not gonna be the same for everyone. That's why I really try to factor in as many variables and try to talk to as many points as possible when I am testing sunscreens, because I want to make this review as applicable for as many people as possible. And for example, that's why a lot of sunscreens that have more oily bases just don't work for me. The Biossence, the Pipette, those bases don't work for my specific skin type. And as a result of that, the filters don't set into my skin as well. And that's why it looks so bad on my skin. skin, and as well as, I mean, they all get greasy and whatnot. They're not fun to wear. But those sunscreens sometimes work a lot better for deeper skin tones that have drier skin, because those vehicles, that oil base, works better for that skin type. Going back to taking certain reviews and people's opinions with a grain of salt and having to form your own opinions, that kind of goes back to that. But on a similar note, price point's also a big factor, because again, you need to be putting on roughly a quarter to a half teaspoon to cover your face, your ears, and your neck, and consistently reapply as well if you're in high UV exposure to maintain consistent protection every day. And so if you have a 50 ml sunscreen and it costs you $30 and you're gonna go through this in like 2 weeks, you're gonna blow through your bank like crazy. It doesn't make any sense. And so especially with what I like to review and what I like to recommend, price point is a big factor in accessibility and people's wanting to use sunscreen. And that's why kind of heartbreaking to see this not do so well, because Purito's affordable and people liked it. But yeah, always factor in price point when talking about sunscreen, just because again, going back to what dermatologists recommend, they recommend expensive sunscreens. That's a big no-no for me. That's why I try to make as many of my reviews accessible. And on a similar point, I get questions a lot of times why I haven't reviewed the 11 by Venus Williams sunscreen, why I don't review Supergoop sunscreens, and overall why I don't recommend a lot of Luxe sunscreens. And that just comes down to price point. Unless I'm getting it as PR, I don't want to spend the money on it, and I don't want you guys to spend your money on it just to be able to get a sunscreen that might work for you, when there's a lot better or comparable formulas and vehicles and textures for a much lower price point. With that all being said, make sure you find a sunscreen that works for you, fits your needs, that you want to wear every day, and that looks good on your skin, that fits within your budget, and that you want to apply, and more importantly, reapply. A sunscreen like that does exist for you. You just got to kind of sift through them all, and that's why I do what I do, just because I try to do that work for you. I jump in front of that bullet so you don't got to. So back to Purito. Last talking point, I promise. Let's wait for more from the company. Granted, what Inky Decoder offered us was very promising. It was multivariable in vivo studies showcasing very consistent results. But until I hear from Purito, I'm not going to jump to any rash decisions, make any rash choices, besides filming this video. There's a lot of other factors in play here, and I just wanna hear what Purito has to say. But beyond that, don't jump to conclusions about every other sunscreen you own either. Not every sunscreen is made the same. Again, not every sunscreen has the same overall factors. A lot comes down to specific individualized formulations. Always comes back to that point. But I just don't want you losing hope in your sunscreens and question the integrity or the actual functionality of your sunscreen on the day-to-day basis. At the end of the day, again, sunscreen is sunscreen. It does what it needs to do to some capacity, and you should be wearing it no matter what, just because again, there's a lot more studies showcasing the damage that the sun itself can do on unprotected skin, then there are studies showing how damaging sunscreen is to the skin, or even questioning if sunscreen's even relevant to wear on a daily basis. My only question is, as a result of all this, why they didn't use higher percentages of the filters that they used, or maybe pair it up with a different filter that offered a bigger bump in protection, for example, Tinosaur, which could cover the entire spectrum in itself. Like, are they gonna change that? What is Purito gonna say? I don't know. But with all that being said, which was a mouthful, thank you guys for watching. Make sure you hit that subscribe button and notification bell so that you know when I post more skincare, sunscreen, fenty-related content on my channel. And down below, I know I just said a lot to you. I know there might be a lot of questions or comments. Leave those down in the comments below. Let's have conversations, let's have discourse. What are your thoughts on the Purito controversy? What are the questions you have about sunscreen formulation? What comments do you have about sunscreen formulation? Let me know. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye.